Kaiser Wilhelm II had been a figure of much debate over the years. To some, the Kaiser was an ambitious but misunderstood leader who was hampered in his productive efforts by a hostile European establishment. To others, the Kaiser was an abrasive, unstable, and inept politician who succeeded in souring ties with even his monarch relatives, ultimately setting the stage for World War I. Born to Princess Victoria of Britain and Frederick William of Prussia, Wilhelm from the very beginning was dealt a harsh hand as a complication with his delivery led one of his arms to become paralyzed, a disability he'd carry for the remainder of his life, and which is said to have embittered him to Britain as it was both a British physician who delivered him and his British grandmother Queen Victoria who'd sent the physician to begin with. Later in his life, the failure of British physicians to save his father's life would reaffirm this embitterment as he would proceed to go on a tirade of how the British have caused him nothing but pain. Wilhelm proved to be an intelligent and tactical young man throughout his schooling, however was prone to emotional outbursts and aggressiveness toward others, something which his father and grandfather had hoped to foster into a focused warrior spirit through discipline and military duty, which Wilhelm took to very quickly. However, Wilhelm would lose both his father and grandfather in the same year, and find the role of Kaiser thrust upon him at a time when he himself felt he was unprepared for the role. To make matters worse, Wilhelm was constantly pulled between the influence of his father and that of Otto von Bismarck, who sought to raise the young Wilhelm to carry on his work, either directly or through proper appointments. But by the time Wilhelm took the throne, the two were at odds with each other. Bismarck held little respect for Wilhelm, who he believed was emotionally volatile and easily manipulated, recognizing that this aspect of Wilhelm had not matured over the years, and would ultimately spell his downfall. In the years which led up to the Great War, Germany would find itself in regular disputes with Russia, France, and Britain over matters both large and petty, despite both the monarchs of Britain and Russia being Wilhelm's own cousins. Opportunities for peace and reconciliation were repeatedly mishandled and foregone, often directly by Wilhelm himself. And it's not surprising then that these actions had cost him a great deal of popularity, even in his own empire. As a matter of fact, the Kaiser's legacy became so tarnished in the eyes of some that it had been suggested others actually acted on his behalf for several actions attributed to him, both positive and negative, something which may not be very far-fetched when we consider the Shadow Kaiser role Wilhelm played during the Great War, in which governmental power had essentially been vested in the military, with the Kaiser only retaining the power of political appointment. By 1918, Wilhelm would have lost major support from much of Germany, his few supporters being those of Prussia who still recognized him as their king, but no longer as emperor of the German people. When the war was lost, Wilhelm had attempted to surrender the crown of emperor and maintain the crown of Prussia, but found the two were constitutionally bound and one could not be separated from the other, and so Wilhelm abdicated and went into exile in the Netherlands, allowing Germany to come under the rule of the Weimar Republic. Yet, despite the Kaiser's follies and fall from popularity, there was still within Germany a longing for monarchy and even a direct restoration of the Kaiser, once again primarily from the Prussian population. The role of the Kaiser had been interlinked with the concepts of both a united German people and a safeguard to the national faith, which without the Kaiser or some strong unifying force seemed at risk of collapse. As a response, the post-war period had seen numerous monarchist and restoration parties established, which aimed to return the Kaiser or one of his sons to the throne. These parties often too opposed the Treaty of Versailles and sought to regain lost lands and colonial possessions while rebuilding the nation's military to claim once again its place as a great power of Europe, doing so as a means to restore German pride and dignity lost in the Great War. These parties existed as a constant opposition to the Weimar establishment, in most cases wishing to disband the system entirely and install an authoritarian order, even if it need be under the president instead of the Kaiser, so long as it was a singular force that could maintain unity and restore strength without the back and forth of bickering democracy. And while these parties did gain greater traction in the mid-20s, they soon found themselves overshadowed by the rapidly expanding National Socialist German Workers' Party, who would go on to assimilate much of their support base and even draw in members of the monarchist party. Soon the monarchist movement shrunk, only feeding this new party which was quickly filling its place, and which would ultimately ban or assimilate them following the Enabling Act of 1933. What remained was the exiled Kaiser Wilhelm II, who until his death hoped in vain that the monarchy would be restored, even refusing to be buried in German soil until a member of his house once again wore the crown. Today, Germany is of course a parliamentary republic, though heirs to the throne do still exist, as do minor movements still for a restored monarchy, even if only as a figurehead or royal celebrity, a lingering, longing trace of the past Germany had left behind. But what if that changed? What if the German monarchists had replaced the National Socialists as Germany's new leading party, and restored a member of Wilhelm's house to the throne? The movement which had come closest in our timeline had been the German National People's Party, a large alliance of conservative, monarchist, and Volkish elements, who, as stated before, sought to reinstall the monarchy, overrule the Versailles Treaty, and reclaim all lost land of the empire, While Wilhelm himself was not a popular contender for the revived throne, there was a good deal of optimism for his son, Crown Prince William III, an avid supporter of German expansion and critic of the Weimar government, who himself had hoped to run for president against the incumbent Hindenburg, but was discouraged from doing so by his father. In this alternate timeline, that changes. Wilhelm III, in cooperation with the monarchists, manages to build an overwhelming level of support on par with that of the National Socialists of our timeline, and following a victory, revises the constitution and restructures the German state back into an empire. As president, or now Kaiser, Wilhelm would have the power to dismiss and appoint a chancellor capable of carrying out his will without the approval of the Reichstag, as well as suspend civil liberties under Article 48, utilizing this to eliminate major opposition and ultimately pass legislation parallel to the Enabling Act, and establish the perpetual leadership of the Kaiser. Now, despite the altered leadership, this Germany actually would have much in common with that of our own world. Like the National Socialist, the German National People's Party, among other things, placed a strong emphasis on the idea of the German Volk, and envisioned the creation of a pan-Germanic empire which encompassed much of the Lebensraum territory. However, unlike in our world, the prestige of the German Kaiser would add a greater level of diplomatic power to negotiations, which may well substitute a need for military action. What we might see in this alternate world is the establishing of a looser union with Austria under the grounds of maintaining order in what would have been an increasingly turbulent period for the state, under the condition of protecting Austrian Catholicism from the dominant Prussian Protestant culture. There is also a chance the younger generations of Austrians, among whom the Volkisch movement was popular, may in later years see more eye to eye with the Northern Protestants and refine a more united Germanic Christian faith, something akin to what Heinrich Himmler had attempted to do with his neo-pagan doctrine for the SS. Relations with Turkey would also be better fostered, as the Kaiser's family had maintained popularity among the Turks and served as a more inviting ally than Hitler had. Additionally, German and Polish relations would of course be brought into discussion. Germany had been adamant about reclaiming the territory of Danzig, which had been ceded to Poland in our timeline, and separated the continuous German state from Eastern Prussia. In our own timeline, there were several attempts to repurchase the land from Poland, as well as a call for a referendum of reunion by the then German inhabitants of the region. Poland, however, refused, thus inciting Germany to invade, but prior to this, Germany had attempted to establish with Poland an alliance for mutual security against the Soviets, which Poland rejected in favor of two non-aggression pacts with the USSR and Germany, and, well, we know how that went. A contributing factor to the negotiations had been that the Polish didn't perceive Hitler as so direct a threat as they did the Soviets. After all, he technically wasn't an imperialist German, he was an Austrian. However, with a Prussian in charge of Germany, Poland is much more on edge and may be more willing to compromise for enduring peace in the West so that it may focus instead on the East and the Prometheism Project, a shared goal with the German Kaiser to weaken Russia, now the USSR, by balkanizing it into a series of ethnic republics. To Poland, Western expansion depended wholly on the wishes of the Entente and how much they chose to, quote, squeeze Germany. But in a world where the German Empire rebounds, so would the Poles be made to set their sights eastward instead, joining Germany, Turkey, the Baltics, and Finland in an alternate anti-Comintern pact, focused on preventing the spread of communism to their own countries. Since the Kaiser and his party would be more unwilling to negotiate with the Soviets without the terms of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact go on high alert and proceed to rapidly militarize against what would have come to be perceived as an invasion force. The Poles, always suspicious of the Germans, would take to establishing their own private alliance with Romania, Hungary, and Czechoslovakia in the event of a German betrayal, all the while building closer ties with Finland, Estonia, and Latvia, who'd also been suspicious of German domination. Lithuania alone remaining an exclusive ally to Germany, out of fear that Poland may attempt a direct annexation should war break out. The new German monarchy would have no shortage of enemies close to home, most commonly communists, Weimar Republicans, and remnant National Socialist elements. Given that in this alternate world the monarchists would have siphoned away the majority of traditionalist support from the National Socialist movement, what remains of them may have been less like what we saw in our own timeline, and more akin to the Strasserist movement, which placed a heavier emphasis on anti-capitalist policy, although it's unlikely the Strasserists would take to military action considering the German National People's Party would share at least a few goals with them. However, if the Soviets were to become involved, the Strasserists could become a powerful asset against the Kaiser, much like Lenin and the Bolsheviks were used against Tsar Nicholas. France by this point had been experiencing its own series of turmoils. Just as in Spain years earlier, economic conditions were difficult, government was becoming increasingly ineffective, and divisions were growing rapidly between a more prominent left-wing and right-wing bloc, notably under the banners of the French Popular Front and the French Popular Party. I've often said that if not for the outbreak of World War II and the immediate conquest of France by Germany, that the French would have seen their own civil war in the following months or years. In this alternate timeline, without the German invasion of Poland, so does France enter the throes of this civil conflict, seeing major intervention from Italy, Spain, the USSR, and Britain, who all held interests in preventing the rise of their opposing faction. Germany would seize upon this opportunity, utilizing the chaos of the French conflict to reclaim its former colonial possession of Cameroon, Japan doing the same in a liberation of Indochina from French occupation. France, as was the case with Spain, would sire a nationalist government, eager to develop an alliance with other like-minded nations, who would come to form the Latin Alliance and Economic Cooperation Community, a movement primarily pushed by Mussolini as a means to assert Latin autonomy and self-sufficiency from Britain, Germany, and the Soviets. The alliance would extend to Greece and Portugal, who would have seen their own nationalist governments come to power, yet would be less inclined to align themselves with Italy. At this time, Japan would have made sweeping campaigns through northern China, and now unsettled the Soviets as Mongolia came under occupation. Japanese invasion of the Philippines and increasing aggression in the Pacific would soon draw American intervention to the island empire. The Soviets, now sufficiently prepared and suspicious of a coordinated attack by both the Japanese and Germans, would launch a preemptive strike against the Baltic states and attempt an invasion of Poland, one repelled with German support and aided by Ukrainian resistance. The Intermarium Alliance would become a barbed shield for Germany, who would come to see Polish survival as essential to German security, lending their own support in that of allied Turkey to undo the damage that had been done by sending Lenin to Russia all those years ago. While the Soviets' Western Front saw significant loss in the regions of the Ukraine and Belarus, they and the Americans had nearly converged upon Japan. Soviet Turkestan and Communist Chinese forces would in this time establish strongholds for themselves in the southwest of the Republic of China. Conflict would come to a close with the capture of Japan in the east and a stalemate with Poland in the west. Concession of captured land is made, making of Poland, the Ukraine, and Baltics a large buffer state securing Germany from Soviet expansion, while it itself now felt confident in its capability to deter Russian and German aggression. Large portions of Chinese land would find themselves annexed into the Soviet republics of Turkestan and Mongolia, the People's Republic of China remaining officially independent as a buffer between the Republic of China and the USSR. The US would move to station troops in the states of Korea and Manchuria to secure them from the Soviets, while Japan remained under joint occupation. The Germans would find themselves ostracized by their Latin and Intermarium neighbors, which no longer hinged on friendships with Germany, or Britain for that matter, and in turn would lead the two monarchies to find an ally in one another, competing with the Latin bloc, Intermarium and Soviets, for various claims and alliances, as a new balance of power settled into order. And that is where I'll end this video for now. The US of Z thanks you for watching. You can pick up a copy of our novel, I Am Uncle Sam, in the links below, support your Legion by liking the video, or join our ranks by subscribing for more. Mr. Z, out.